please welcome to the Leon Loft LP.
Burning like a was falling tender, longing for the days of no surrender years ago. And we're in old. So smoke 'em if you got 'em, 'cause it's going down. All I ever wanted was you. I'll never get to heaven, 'cause I don't know how. Let's raise a glass or two to all the things I've lost on you. Tell me that you love me more than hate me all the time, and you're still mine. So smoke 'em if you got 'em, 'cause it's going down. All I ever wanted was you. Let's take a drink of heaven, it's gotten turned around. Let's raise
back to more music on Ann Arbor's 107.1. You clear? I keep asking that, which is stupid, because if we're not, that goes out on the air.
Yeah, exactly.
It's stupid. All right. We have to do the light thing so I know that we're clear. All right. So I was thinking that the last album, we talked about that at the time, that this was sort of a return to performing, and it was something that you really hadn't done much of in the 10 years that you had been out in Los Angeles writing.
Yeah.
So you had kind of kept away from the stage, and you were getting back into it, starting really about 2012. This album, you are continuing the performance. So I will assume that that is building on the positives that came out of touring
last album.
Yeah,
like, it's a lot more than like, you know, I mean, I was, you know, I think like, 2006 is when I signed that first major label deal, you know, and that was when I kind of, you know, really stopped touring, because I'd been touring a bunch, you know, like before that, like 3 or 4 years before that, and it all led up to that. And then I just, they just wanted me to write songs, you know, for my possible record. Mm-hmm. But it was 3 years in the system, and I had amassed about 140 songs, you know, and none of them, nothing came out. But one song got cut by the Backstreet Boys. And that was interesting, you know, to me. I was like, really? You know, right. It's like, no, that's no good. But the Backstreet Boys can use one of those songs. That's great. You know, I mean, it was just like a bizarro moment. But like, but I also just was like, oh, you know, okay. Like, I mean, I think that's been like my ability to survive in this business a lot is because I'm just like, I guess, cool, you know. Like, okay. I don't, you know, because I think you know, in a way, I was lucky because I was tolerant. You know, I think I've seen a lot of people be a lot more like, kind of like, won't stand for it kind of thing. And I respect that too. But I think that they're like, more often than not, like, it ends. You know what I mean? And I just was like, you know, kind of, I just thought it was like, be cool to be a songwriter as well. And then also you didn't have to deal with all the pushing and pulling of, you know, like, look this way, sound like this, do this, wait for this, wait for that.
To be a performing artist.
Yes, yeah. Exactly. So in 2009, I signed a publishing deal, and just like, I remember my publisher, I still like bust his balls about this. Like, he like looked at me, he's like, so you're done being an artist, right? And then when like all this stuff started popping up, it's like, this is fantastic, this is great. And I was like, you didn't want me to be an artist. He's like, I would never say that to you. It was really funny, you know. Typical.
The last time that you really were out touring, you know, on the first two albums, mm-hmm. East Coast, the East Coast years, did it feel differently when you went back to being an artist on that last album, and now you're moving into another cycle? Did it feel different?
I did this thing. It didn't feel like it was. Yeah, yes and no. Mm. I mean, I think I've taken everything with me to, like, you know, like you do in life to become what you are. I started playing in, I started doing one night a week at this, like, just one or two songs, just for fun, like, you know, a drunken hang with, like, a bunch of Hollywood people, and my writer friends would come down, and I'd sing a cover. And the response was, like, really great, and it was like, you know, it was fun again to like just do that, and it had no pressure. I used to read lyrics off my phone if I didn't know it, and but it started to get like people started coming down just to see me, and then and people were like starting to notice that, and it all kind of came together in this perfect storm of like I had that a big Rihanna hit, and I was writing stuff for myself, and people were starting to take notice, and I got the commercial came and all this stuff, and so Warner Brothers didn't know about that, but about the commercial. But they came in right at that moment, and like I signed to them, and it was just like it was like just this perfect little storm of hype and all coming together. And I was actually very surprised, you know, but pleasantly surprised. And yes, it was different when I started playing with Joey Dosik and company. And it was really. You know, when I did this thing that's like around online a lot is the East West sessions. It's like me in front of this like blue green like lit stage, and we made that just to see where we were at with what songs I had, and then we put it out because it came out so nice. Mm. So it was like it was a different feeling. You know, like it felt very like, you know, and I think that's why I also got very like open with like. All right, let's spend a lot of money on this record. You know, 24-piece orchestras, David Campbell, Beck's dad doing like, you know, like composing strings for it. But, you know, I'm also very happy that like my $1.6 million bill that I had with Warner Brothers is done because I got dropped. You know,
it's like,
thank you very much. Yep. Now I can actually make some money doing what I'm doing. So like everything, again, like, you know, I know it's a really annoying thing to hear, like everything happens for a reason. And you know, I have this huge ship tattooed on my chest. And that's like when people said it's the journey, I'd be like, shut the fuck up, man. I swear to God, I'll kill you where you stand, you know? But like, I finally understood that, you know, and it really, you know, and for me, I think, you know, all my heroes seem like they've been through some stuff. So, I mean, I'm happy to have done it.
So now you know it is the journey.
Yeah, it is.
Well, you're saying it. Did you say 140 songs, by the
way? Yeah.
What period of time?
From 2006 to 2009. It was just like, it was the first
time
I... Just
to give an idea, by the way, people get publishing deals for one song a month. Like, that, you can get a publishing deal for one song a month.
Yeah.
So that's a lot
of songs.
Yeah,
well, they just like, I don't know. I, like, that was a weird thing. I just was like, I just took to it like that. You know, before that, I had written like my 13 to 15 songs a year, put them on a CD and been like, I'm a genius, you know? But then when I was forced to do this, I realized I could. And now, like, and that served me very well as well, because I can just like jump in to a session anytime, you know? And I mean, sometimes, yeah, it's not there or whatever, but I feel very, I can do that on command, which, you know, because it's considerably less glamorous to be a songwriter. It's like demanded of you. Like, you know, you go on a songwriting trip to like Tokyo or something like that, and they're like, they're knocking on your door the next morning, like to get up and do an 8-hour session with some new artist. Mm-hmm. And it's not like, I'm not really feeling it today, sorry. You know, right. It's like, yeah, you better get in that room.
It's good to know how to turn it on and off, though.
Yeah, it was helpful.
What do you want to do next?
I don't know. I'd either do Into the Wild or I could do Muddy Waters. What do you think?
I would say Muddy Waters.
Yeah? All right, let's do it. Sorry, I just laid that on. This is J.D. Carrera. We're going home today. We're very excited because we've been out on this radio promo tour for a while, and it's fun. I mean, I've been out even longer than this guy, so he can, he's a lucky guy. Anyway, thanks, J.D. All right. Edge and tempting all the steps to follow close right behind. Is it only when you feel the pot is empty that it's gnawing out the corners of your mind? I will ask you for mercy, I will come to you blind. What you'll see is the worst me, not the last of my kind. In the muddy water we're falling. Oh, in the muddy water we're crawling. Hold me down, hold me now, sold me out. In the muddy water we're falling. By a pathway where we end is not the way that we had planned. All the spirits gather around like it's our last day. To get across, you know, we'll have to raise the sand. I will ask you for mercy, but I will come to you blind. What you'll see is the worst me, not the last of my kind. Oh,
everybody, water, we're crying. Are we on the lonely side? Say, whoa, now, the past long way. Now we so lost in the dark of our hearts. That whoa, now, there's no light of day. No,
thank you so much. JD?